Friends, we are starting now. Today's topic is the challenges of the Supreme Court practice. The speaker is Mr. Sri Subodh Markandeya, senior advocate, senior most person. Even earlier times also, he addressed us. Even last time when we have this 100th meeting, he edited the entire articles which you have written by this thing. Even midnight also, he spent a lot of time. Sir, we are very grateful to you, sir. You are here once again. Very important topic, that's why we are requesting you once again. So that, I mean, you are the best person as for whatever experience you have. So several other things, sir. Sir, before, normally our practice is, sir, introduction one by one, 45 minutes speech, 15 minutes question answer, then followed by cup of tea, sir. Name?
Seshagiri.
Shekhar Kriti.
Anil Kumar.
Sandeep Kalia.
Prasanth Kumar Mishra.
Neeraj Shivas.
Ajit Kulsresh.
Amit Pratap Singh.
Anand.
Please go ahead, you just.
Around
Saravana.
Gupta, sir.
Suresh.
Naresh Kumar.
So what? You
in
Sir. Sir, please.
Some 2 weeks back I had the occasion to do some program for NDTV, and I told the young audiences there that Supreme Court practice is full of challenges and surprises and uncertainties. See, SLP is just like toss of coin. We don't know whether it will be granted or refused. So the vagaries of practice itself is the first challenge. Now, another challenge which we now experience more and more is how to get our, if I have taken an order in my favor from the Supreme Court, my troubles start. So that's a challenge. Mr. Devkinandan Prasad, an educational officer from Bihar, got a constitutional bench judgment in his favor, saying that, pension is money, pension is property. You cannot deny a pension without following the due procedure of law. But you know, minions in the secretariat are not impressed. It took him 12 years thereafter to get his dues according to the Supreme Court judgment. Now, I started in this court with a brief from Mr. D. Rajayaraj and P.T. Reddy. That was way back in 1965. That was my first brief in the Supreme Court. And I think when till the state of Andhra Pradesh itself was bifurcated in 2014.
Yeah, 2014.
P.T. Reddy was still in the court. His seniority vis-a-vis, you know, the other part of the state, namely Andhra, had still to be determined. So this is a great challenge. Merely obtaining judgment of the Supreme Court doesn't. In the article which I wrote for the souvenir, I have dealt with this. So this is a very great challenge. And this also happens because there are rounds and rounds of litigation. Supreme Court again sends you back to administrative tribunal, to High Court, to Supreme Court, to again there are you are tossed about. So that's a great challenge. So with this, you know, let us start. Now let's survey the power of the Supreme Court under the Constitution and the laws. To my mind, the provision of paramount importance is Article 32. This morning I just took out Constituent Assembly debates and I was just trying to assess for how many days this debate on Article 32 went on. I turned the pages and I found it was too large to comprehend. So I thought I may make a general statement that for days together this article was debated, and pages after pages that those debates in this constituent. Therefore, Article 32, to my mind, is the most important article for us as lawyers, because it confers upon the Supreme Court power to enforce the fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are all there in Part 3 of the Constitution, and to enforce them, the constitutional remedies have been provided in Article 32. So, as I said, the overarching importance of Article 32 is to be found in the long debates, page after page, in the Constituent Assembly, day after day after day. Now, this Article 32 itself is a fundamental right. You can enforce that right. You can enforce the right under Article 32. And there is a old judgment, I think, Premchand Garg's case. There, previously in Supreme Court, whenever a person filed a writ petition, he had to deposit a sum of rupees 2,000 in the registry towards the cost of the respondent, if any. So Mr. Premchand Garg challenged this rule made by the Supreme Court itself in exercise of its power under Article 145. And court considered that and said, yes, this puts a fetter on the petitioner to have his remedy under Article 32. So court struck down its own rule. So you can just imagine how lethal Article 32 is. I would say that, you know, the constitutional amendment would be required to cause a slight abridgment of the fundamental rights. See, in ADM Jabalpur's case, the court held that during emergency you don't have right to any remedy under Article 32. Now, our Puttaswamy's case recently, 9 judges bench have held that no, they have overruled the ADM Jabalpur's case. So now what's the effect? Effect is that even during emergencies, you can come to the Supreme Court and get your right enforced. Now there is another aspect which I would like to dwell on, and that is that one doesn't have to move the High Court in order to come to Supreme Court under Article 32. What had happened, that is, in one of the earliest cases in the before the Supreme Court, in Ramesh Thapar versus State of Madras, the Advocate General of the then State of Madras argued that why did Ramesh Thapar come here? He should have gone to the Madras High Court. The court rejected that argument and said, no, in order that it's a right to constitutional remedy. Article 32 itself is a fundamental right. He can as well come here. But on practical terms, we know that these days Supreme Court does not entertain, except pills and corporate writ petitions. I don't think they entertain. This trend had started in 80s. So at that time, we had discussion at the bar. We also used to tell the court that please lay down the guidelines. If you don't want to entertain a writ petition under Article 32, please specify so that the litigant doesn't come and bother you. He will go wherever his remedy is. But that has not happened, with the result that Chancellor Foot, we don't know whether your writ petition will be entertained or not entertained. A very interesting thing happened in one of the cases in my chamber. A lady called Asha Sharma, she filed a writ petition here, matter related to Noida. So it came up before Justice Desai and Venkat Ramayya. So Mr. Desai, Justice Desai wasn't bothered about this. He was bothered about the right of the citizen. He never bothered about the... So, but because of Justice Venkat Ramayya, he asked me, why has the lady not gone to Allahabad High Court? Tell me one good reason. So I told him that I'm rather shy to tell why I didn't go to Allahabad High Court and came to Supreme Court. So he said, court is asking you a question, answer. So I said, the lady is in a pregnant stage, she can't go all the way to Allahabad High Court. They entertained and gave her whatever relief was. So that's, I think that's enough about Article 32. Now let's come to Article 129. This is power to punish for contempt. Supreme Court, as you all know, is a court of record, and as court of record it can punish for its own contempt. Now this remedy is, we can't say this is like a remedy under contempt of court act or any other law. This is a constitutional remedy. This power to punish for contempt is not under contempt of court act or any other law. Its roots are constitutional. It's a plenary power. It's unfettered by, one immediate distinction which comes to mind is that it's unfettered by any law of limitation. In a proper case, citizen can come and enforce contempt of court through this remedy without being fettered by any limitation. The next article is Article 131. It empowers the Supreme Court to decide all the disputes between the Union and one or more states on one side, or intercede between states in original suits. So Supreme Court has ordinary original jurisdiction whenever the claims are between the Union and the state. Now, kindly see the proviso. Proviso to this article excludes specifically the disputes arising from any treaty, agreement, sanad, etc., which the central government has entered into with the rulers of the Indian states. As you know, at the advent of our independence, there were 500 and odd states in India, and through instruments of accession, they all merged with the Dominion of India, and that's how Union of India came into existence. So any treaty, agreement, sanad, etc. between the Maharaja or the Nawab on one hand and the Dominion of India cannot be subject matter of any adjudication under Article 131. That is because it's an act of state. Then you will find that Article 363 also makes the same exclusion. Now Article 132 of the Constitution has the power, the Supreme Court has the power to decide appeals, civil or criminal, which arise by certificate of the High Court, that it involves interpretation of the Constitution. So this has more or less become obsolete now. Certificate appeals are no longer in vogue, though to my mind it was a good filtration process before you directly come to Supreme Court under Article 136. These provisions were very salutary, 132, 133, 134. The High Court used to look at the whole, it has already adjudicated, so it used to say whether it's a fit case for appeal to Supreme Court or not. That was called certificate. But we have somehow removed it. I don't know why we have removed it, but in 1970s and 1980s, we were little, all courts, litigant, everyone was very, quick justice. But justice is not just justice rendered by Supreme Court. Justice is also justice rendered by a munsif or civil judge, or that's also justice. I was fond of saying that you require a a sentinel on the PVY, not only at the apex level, but at every level. So, Article 133 empowered the Supreme Court to decide civil appeals arising by certificate granted by the High Court that the case involves a substantial question of law of public importance, and it is required to be, so two things had to be certified, that it involves a substantial question of law of wide public importance, and number two, it is required to be decided by the Supreme Court. These were the two contents of the certificate. So as I said, this equally applies to Article 133. It has become obsolete. Because in our anxiety to come directly to Supreme Court, we have done away with it. But actually, today one of the challenges of the Supreme Court is the numbers. Numbers is a huge, huge problem, and I don't think we are addressing the way we ought to. Numbers is a huge, docket explosion is huge. In 1980, I had the occasion to take a survey in connection with an article I wrote for Bar Council of India Journal, and I found that in that year, 1981, Supreme Court had entertained something like 15,000 specially petitioned civil, 13,000 specially petitioned criminal, and 15,000 writ petitions under Article 32 of the Constitution. So almost 45,000 cases way back in 1981. For a court comprising of just less than 20 judges, it's a huge burden. And now, you know, in the year of grace, 2019, the problem has, I think, gone beyond control. In my chamber, Jagdish Prasad Patel's case on the daily list is lingering for the last 3 years. 3 years, not yet reached. So it's a huge problem which all of us should address. And filtration process is one of the ways. Why do we think that only Supreme Court can give justice? I think every court should be able to give justice. If there is some deficiency, and I think huge, there is huge deficiency down there. There is no doubt about it. My colleagues who go to lower courts tell me that atmosphere is totally different. But then, be that as it may, we must improve. We must all of us put our heads together and improve. Justice is not justice what is delivered by Supreme Court. Justice is also what is delivered by Civil Judge Junior Division. So I'll not bother anything about Article 135 because those were appeals pending before this federal court at the inception of the Supreme Court in 1950, so they had to dispose them of. Now, Article 136. This is our bread and butter also. So, Supreme Court has been conferred with the power to grant special leave to appeal under Article 136 from any judicial order. Any judicial order. Therefore, interim, final, every order. Not only, I think if you look at the expression, it's a very wide expression. Any determination, any judgment, decree, order, or determination. So, very wide expression. But whenever there is a wide expression, you must always, its use should be narrow. See, if you look at Privy Council, I mean, today our young people don't need to look at Privy Council. But when we started, when I became a lawyer, Constitution was just 12 years old. So we did look at what Privy Council used to do. And I think Privy Council entertained, I don't think it ever entertained more than 100 special petitions. It's called specially petition. So there has to be something special about it. It has become more than ordinary. I think this year number may be touching 50. Last year number touched 50,000 specially petitions. So, and therefore the disposal is so, it has come grinding halt. We should all be concerned about this. So as I said here, 50,000 litigants across the country, they avail this remedy. No, it's true that it's a remedy which gives access to justice. But now time has come somehow, somewhere to filter. How to filter is a question. And we must all be aware of the baneful effect of the unfettered resort to this remedy. Docket explosion is definitely traceable to the unfettered resort to Article 136. It's time to provide for some filtration mechanism. Now, the next article is 137. Supreme Court has been conferred with the power to review its own judgment, decree, order under Article 137. Earlier, all review petitions used to come in open court. But again, you know, I think we started filing review petitions in every case. So in 1980s, or probably earlier, they amended the Supreme Court rules to provide that review petitions will be disposed of in chambers. So I was one of the, there were a large number of writ petitions challenging this rule. I was also one of them. And it was disposed of in Ishwara versus Registrar of Supreme Court. I had the occasion to tell the bench that there is no alternative to open court, because we don't know what you do in chambers. Do we know what they do in chambers? We don't know. Whether they read, not read. Yes, I'm about to say, reading by judge is another challenge. This has again become a challenge. Reading of brief by the judge, because special leave is granted or not granted, depends all on reading by the judge. And if he doesn't read, he just does. We are all, every day we are, our clients are victims of non-reading. Previously, you could be sure that nothing was unread. Even your trash was read, and for judges used to point out, that's trash you have written in your SLP. But today we are not sure whether they read. So I told Justice Krishna Iyer, because he was saying, no, reading with concentration is far better than in the open court. Yes, correct. Provided you do that. If you don't do that, then I'm not quite sure. Yes, if you do read with concentration, yes, my SLP will be granted in no time. No. If it has merits and if it is properly articulated, yes. So, in Ishwara versus Registrar Supreme Court of India, they upheld the constitutional validity of that particular rule. Now one window has been opened, at least in death cases. The court is hearing you. Yeah. But I think on the civil side also there could be some cases which also require this kind of treatment. Yes, death cases must be heard. Even review must be heard. I would say that curative must also be heard in the open court if someone has filed. Death is, you are extinguishing life, you are putting an end to life. Therefore, yes, it's a very salutary provision they have made now. So, Article 139 empowers the Supreme Court to transfer to itself cases pending in different high courts involving same question and decide them and it also empowered the Supreme Court to transfer a case from one High Court to the other. See, Article 142 for us is as important as Article 136, because Supreme Court has been conferred with the unique power to do complete justice. Complete justice. Now, see, in service matter, this is a real great problem, that complete justice is not. Because what happens that Supreme Court says that, for example, in promotion cases, Supreme Court said promoting is not my business. I can only see whether he is entitled to promotion or not. It's the business of the bureaucrats in the secretariat to promote or not promote. But of course, some window was opened by one bench saying that no, once or twice if you don't promote, then different considerations will arise. Then I will see whether promotion has been done or not. And I'll, with my judicial order, promote it. But in actual practice, this does not happen. As I said, that five-judge bench, Devki Nandan Prasad, it took only 4 years for, less than 4 years for the Supreme Court to adjudicate upon his claim of pension as his fundamental right to property, because in those days right to property was a fundamental right. So, but it took him 12 years and another writ petition in the Supreme Court, and very sympathetic judges, mind you. It came up before Desai and he said that I'm warning you here and now that if you do not give to Mr. Devkinanda Prasad whatever is his due, then straight away, without anything more, I'll haul you up for contempt. But then, as we know, contempt also has its own constraints. What will they do? Send him for 6 months. See, prior to the enactment of Contempt of Courts Act, the judges had the power, unfettered power, to imprison them. I think it was Justice Young, a British judge of the Punjab High Court, who sent a litigant for contempt of court for a life term in the jail. That's how the Contempt of Court Act was enacted. But of course, Supreme Court is sending them till the decree or order is complied with. But otherwise, 6 months is not all. So, these are practical problems. So Article 142 is a very, very salutary and you require judges of great insight, you know, to invoke Article 142. And one of the best innovative way I found was in B. Prabhakar versus State of Andhra Pradesh. There what had happened, that one fine morning or one bad morning, civil servants of Andhra Pradesh woke up to find that their age of superannuation has been reduced from 58 years to 55 years. So 3 years gone. So they came to Supreme Court. They lost in this. But in the meanwhile, Mr. N.T. Rama Rao, the Chief Minister, who was the author of this kind of act, he had better thoughts, so he enacted, or his successor in office, Chief Minister, he enacted a law saying, yes, age is restored to 58 years, but this will not apply to the persons who have already retired, namely those who are victims, they will be excluded from. So again, fresh round of litigation. So, anticipating all this, Justice Chinnappa Reddy, at the end of his judgment, he wrote nine directions, giving in detail how the government will work out, and every little pie, he ensured that every pie to the victimized civil servants was paid. That's how. So this takes me to Article 143, the opinion judgment. Supreme Court has been conferred with the power to President ask for opinion, and it Supreme Court either gives or respectfully refuses to give. But this includes the question relating to treaty agreement, sanad, etc. Yes, President can ask for an opinion. Now there is a little catch here. Previously, any whatever opinion was not supposed to be declaration of law. It was not supposed to be declaration of law. Therefore, it could not be cited in a court of law. That Supreme Court has taken this view. But in special reference number one, that is relating to special courts, immediately after emergency, the opinion of the Supreme Court was asked for by the President, whether the special courts bill, which was pending before the Lok Sabha, whether it's constitutional law. It's like advance ruling. So the Supreme Court there held for the first time that this is declaration of law. After all, we have heard large number of counsel. It's not an exercise in futility. So now it's binding. Now we have a very unique system in our country, that is the all doubts and disputes relating to the election to the offices of President and Vice President has to be decided in election petition before the Supreme Court under Article 71. Now Supreme Court has another special kind of jurisdiction, and that is when it decides, the references made by the President in regard to the disciplinary action to be taken against the chairpersons and members of the Union Public Service Commission or State Public Service Commissions under Article 317, and similar power in regard to the references made by the governors for State Public Service Commissions under Article 3172. Now, as if Supreme Court did not have enough power, the provisions of Article 138, 139, 140 enable the Parliament to enlarge, confer supplemental power on the Supreme Court. So now let's turn to the power of the Supreme Court conferred by various laws. What we have dealt with is what has been conferred by the Constitution. Now we will see what has been conferred by various laws. Appeals under Section 38 of the Advocates Act. So I will just go through very quickly, because our Order 23 of our rules enacted in 2013 that deal with the appeals under Advocates Act. Court fee is to be paid. Court fee has burgeoned now. Supreme Court was cheapest court in the world. Before 2013 rules came into force. Very, very affordable court. Now it has become. No, nothing wrong. Then appeals under Section 116 of the Representation of People's Act. So 20,000 court fee, yes, politicians can afford. I think it can be raised also. Then appeals under the Supreme Court Enlargement of Criminal Appellate Jurisdiction. Then appeals under the Consumer Protection Act. Then appeals under Section 261 of the Income Tax Act. Then appeals under Section 35L of the Central Excise Act. Then appeals under Section 130E of the Customs Act. And then Section 50, 15Z of the Security and Exchange Board Act. Then under Section 23 of the National Green Tribunals Act. And lastly, this is a new jurisdiction which has been created, and it was long overdue. Previously, there was a huge problem on account of the bar in Article 136, the servicemen's
court martial.
Against court martial, there was no. Although such a barrier was not there in Article 226, so we did invoke in earlier part of my career, I remember, we did invoke Article 226, and the judges were, they didn't know that they had power to. I remember one matter coming up before two Sardar judges, and they were very pleased to know that yes, under Article 226 they have power to quash the court martial proceedings. They were very happy to. So the appeals under sections 30 and 31 of the Armed Forces Tribunal. Actually, I would suggest that that we should hold seminars on these appeals, because they require detailed examination. Just myself going, you know, just in a sentence is not enough. Parliament has spent so much time and effort, and so to sum up, this is the kind of jurisdiction we have in the Supreme Court. Writ jurisdiction, original civil, original ordinary civil, original jurisdiction, criminal appellate division jurisdiction, election jurisdiction in regard to president, vice president on the original side, and regarding MPs and MLAs on the appellate side. Then advisory jurisdiction, reference jurisdiction, transfer jurisdiction, professional ethics jurisdiction. Awesome. Advisory jurisdiction, disciplinary jurisdiction relating to chairpersons and members of the Union and State Public Service Commission, military jurisdiction. Isn't there something missing?
No, sir. I'll
no?
No.
So, no, I thought nitty-gritty. Earlier, one whole lecture I had devoted to nitty-gritty and brass tacks of. So, as we all know, special petition is our bread and butter. So there is difference between specially petition criminal and specially petition civil. The forms are different. The bail application is very important. I think we had a very good article in this about the bail. One learned author wrote that bail ought to be more easily. I think he challenged that rule under which, you know, a person has to surrender before invoking the jurisdiction of this. I think it's a very, very insightful article, one of the most insightful articles.
Nagamuttu, maybe.
Nagamuttu. Mr. Nagamuttu wrote a very, very good article. And I think it's high time that particular provision of the Supreme Court rules is amended. Because if the person is entitled to bail while the matter is still pending in the court, I don't know why Supreme Court should enact such a harsh rule. Then writ petition, then PILs. On PILs, I would say it's time to reflect very deeply. PILs must be, we have all done PIL, there is nothing magical about PIL. See, PIL did not originate with Justice Bhagwati, it's a wrong notion altogether. I remember one particular instance where Justice S.M. Sikri, he had used a particular writing by a person from Tihar jail. I think the prisoner did not have any paper also with him. So on the back side of a cigarette box or whatever, he wrote his petition and sent it. The court entertained it. Court entertained and sent him. I think habeas corpus notice was given.
And one postcard also.
Postcard, yes. They used to,
old lady.
Yeah. Justice, yeah. From day one, Supreme Court has all stood for. That is why Supreme Court of India is held in such high esteem. But all of us and all of them, they must all, you know, do their utmost to maintain them. Thank you very much.
I want one question.
Yeah, please.
Is there any President of India or Vice President of India under the advisory power of Supreme Court of India, have taken any advice from the Supreme Court?
Oh, every day. So many advisory. Yes, on various aspects. Including Ram Janmabhoomi, it's widely invoked. Only difference is previously they thought that this is not declaration of law. In Special Court Act, that the Special Code, Special Reference Number 1 of 1979, if I'm not wrong, there they held that the exercise which they held for 3 months, hearing every counsel on every and considering every aspect of the matter, it can't be exercise in futility, surely. It's a declaration of law.
One second. Those who are not received copies, can you raise your hands? Yeah, you will get Monday. You collect from the counter from Monika ji. Huh? All of you go and collect it. I'll get a photocopy and I'll give it 20-25 copies. You just collect it. Please.
Sir, there is only one caveat on your argument and then speech. I want to inform all of them. See, when we started practice, and even you, CRPC and CPC, there is no provision for transfer of a matter pending in Jammu and Kashmir to other than this, because the CRPC says that it will not be applicable to there. 139 capital A constitution also does not permit any cases to be withdrawn from that state to suburb. Now these basical questions have been decided by the constitution bench. There says that the access of a justice is a fall under Article 21. So therefore, the access of justice can be approached by filing a writ petition. So therefore, now we can file a writ petition before Supreme Court seeking a petition pending in Jammu and Kashmir to be transferred rest of the country.
It's a tribute to Supreme Court. Yes. Innovative. They have invoked Article 21 for making good the deficiency which...
Want to give the citation occasion comes.
Please.
It's 2016-8 SCC 509.
Just a minute, sir.
2016-8 SCC 509. It's a constitution bench decision. The reference was by the two judges. Justice Kehar, when he was not the Chief Justice, he referred the matters to the larger bench. And Justice T.S. Thakur, when he was Chief Justice, he constituted the bench. And this point has been decided that the free access of justice and fairless justice is a part of Article 21. So therefore, we can file a writ petition getting passed.
I think it's a different kind of...
Title, bahut cases. First is Anita Kushwaha versus Pushap Sudan.
You circulate it, better circulate it. It's going to be a huge lecture. You circulate it.
I have given only the citation. It's a 16 general.
Thank you. Next question.
Pushap Sudan. P-U-S-H-A-P Sudan. And 15 judgment cases are also.
Any other questions, please?
Very good information.
Excuse me. Anyone? Last final. Okay, Sarvana, please give a vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, sir. I thank I feel very privileged, and it's my pleasure to give a vote of thanks for your excellent lecture. And you have started with by saying that Constituent Assembly has taken such a long time, days together, to debate on Article 32. And you have said that Article 32 is itself a fundamental right, and you can approach Supreme Court for the enforcement of all other fundamental rights. Having said so, but still you have pointed out that Supreme Court is not inclined to entertain 32 petitions. They generally ask the petitioners or litigants to go and approach the High Court under Article 226. And thereafter you have taken us to Article 131, 133, 136 and inherent powers of the Supreme Court 142, and you have summed up all the jurisdictions of the Supreme Court. We are very thankful to you, sir. I would like to end by saying that Justice Shivaraj Patilji used to say, when mind is full of knowledge, it is a storehouse. When knowledge is shared with others, it becomes a lighthouse. So you have become a lighthouse, sir, and you have shed the light towards us. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity.
Can you give that register? Those who are not signed, fine, I mean, you can make it, I mean.